Hey guys, we are Darren and Stephanie, and welcome to our channel. If you've seen any of our videos before, you will know that we have not posted a video in some time. Stephanie has a few health issues, and she's had some major surgeries in the last few months that has left her unable to edit and unable to do much else, and so we haven't recorded much. Additionally, COVID has slowed travel down, and so with camping season over and international travel restricted, we just haven't been on the road much.
During the months that we have kind of been at home and unable to go a couple places, we have been planning what we want to do next. And it looks like 2021 is gonna be another year of maybe some more stateside travel instead of international travel. And we started really considering, you know, our experience camping and what we wanted to get out of camping in the future.
So in our first two camping videos, we featured our Forest River Rpod 180, and we learned a lot from this little camper, so much so that we traded it after 6 months of ownership. And we want to tell you, after our experience with the Rpod, why we traded it, what we liked about it, what we disliked about it. And then we'll do a second follow-up video to this one that will give you a tour of the camper that we're currently sitting in. And we'll tell you the model of that at the end. So stay tuned to the end of this video to figure out which model of camper we purchased. We had actually intended to give you a full detailed tour of the Rpod before we traded it in. And so we went out a couple hours early to our parking spot to film an inside-outside review and explain all the things that we'd encountered trouble with, all the things that we liked, all the things that we disliked. But as with pretty well every time we took the Rpod out, we had another issue in trying to get it to the dealership to trade it. You see, our power tongue jack had died a couple months back, and so we had to manually crank it up and down, which had been pretty easy, but we're pretty sure some water had gotten into the motor head and those gears had seized up while it was parking, and so we had a really difficult time even getting the trailer lifted up onto the truck so we could take it back to trade. And so that took all of our extra time and we didn't get that video shot.
Let me start by saying that we loved parts of our Rpod. We were really excited about small camping and just, you know, a minimal experience. And we loved being the tiny camper at the campground. And we've fallen in love with camping. We really, really liked the experience. And we had kind of talked about, you know, whether or not we wanted to do this moving forward and what kind of camper we wanted long term. So to get started, let's talk through some of the pros for the Rpod. First off, it's a really cool looking camper. It's something that you see and you get really excited about.
They've crammed a lot of features into small packages, and Forest River also has several different Rpod floor plans to kind of fit different needs and wants. The 180, the model that we went with, it suited us very well for what we were after with the first camper. And like Steph said, it had an outdoor kitchen, it had air conditioning, it had heating, it had gas and electric water heating. That trailer was only 20 feet long, the living space was 18, but yet it was still tall enough for me at 6'3 to stand inside in most of the camper. The shower area in the back of ours was kind of rounded, and so I had to duck to shower and things like that. But all in all, really nicely outfitted for such a small camper.
And you still got the full dry bath, which was hard to find in a lot of other small camper models. A lot had wet baths where the shower and the toilet were together and everything would get wet. In the Rpod, you did have that separate shower, and that was a really nice feature that I think kind of drove us to that model.
We were a popular camper in most of the campgrounds. We would see lots of people kind of taco necking a little bit as they went by, taking double takes at our camper, just because it was very small and very compact when you see these big rigs out there.
It was also really cozy. We loved the cozy feeling that we got in that little Rpod. You really felt like you were camping, but you were clean, you were had your AC, and you were comfortable. So that was really everything you could want in a little camper. And that made it, you know, pretty easy to travel around the country.
Some other nice features that were kind of crammed into this tiny package. So just a couple things are, we had a microwave that doubled as a convection oven and a broiler, so you could do basically any type of cooking. There was a double range inside, so a gas stove cooktop, so if it was raining outside and you couldn't use your outside kitchen, you could cook inside in pretty much any fashion. It'd get a little hot with the stove on in such a small place, but it did work fine in a pinch. We had some rainy days and we were able to cook inside. We had a power Thule awning, so name brand there, and it worked well. Just like the big guys, we had our awning and can stay in the shade. It was all electronic. What else was there? The power tongue jack. Of course, ours died, but the factory covered a new one for us. We just hadn't put it on yet. Yeah. So just some nice features. Front and back underneath storage. It wasn't huge, but they did think about storage even in a small camper like that.
And I think if you were stepping up from maybe tent camping or like starting off with like your first little camper, it would be a great little camper for that. It's nice as in a tent, but you don't feel like you're in a house either.
I will say it didn't tow that great. It bounced around and it swayed a little bit with our truck, but it was light, small, and maneuverable. So learning how to back up a camper with something small like that, it was a nice learning tool without having to back up a 30 or 40 foot camper. It was a good one to start with for that.
Now, it being light was one of the selling features for it. And that's kind of why we picked an Rpod. When we first started out, we had our Ford Edge and it had a towing capacity of
3,500 pounds.
And so we were looking for a small light camper because at the time we didn't think we were gonna trade for a truck. But it really seemed to have the most features for what you could fit like under that weight limit. And so we thought that that was gonna work perfectly for our Edge, but it still was kind of a struggle for the Edge. But there are people who are out there towing with SUVs.
And crossovers.
And I'll say the price range for an Rpod was also a good place to start. Although you will pay a little bit of a premium to fit all those features in a tiny camper, it still wasn't too much of a hurdle to get into.
Yeah, especially right now because they're pretty hard to find. And as we all know, camping is booming. And so prices everywhere are up, particularly with these cult followed models like the Rpod.
And that leads me to the last pro, which is that there is a great online community for Rpods. People get really, really excited about this brand of camper. There are some diehard loyal fans of this camper. And they welcomed us into their online community. You can find their Facebook page that has thousands of people out there and they talk about modifications, problems, just anything you would basically want to know about an Rpod. There is a Facebook group and you can find people who have probably had an experience with that issue or have ideas on how to make your Rpod even better.
Yeah, I think that group has something like 17,000 members and you don't have to have an Rpod to join the group. They'll probably ask you if you're shopping as one of the questions to join. But if you are considering an Rpod, I would definitely recommend joining that group. It'll give you a good understanding of what people are dealing with as far as issues and modifications people are making to get the most out of their Rpods. It's really an invaluable resource. I can't remember how many times we had little issues pop up. And we could either search for that exact issue in the forum or ask a question and you'd have 10 answers within a minute and be able to solve your problem on the go pretty quickly if it was solvable. I think that's a pretty good list of the pros, the reasons we like the Rpod, the reason you should consider one, but let's talk about the cons and maybe not necessarily cons, but just reasons that we decided to make a switch only 6 months into camping.
So the main reason we really considered trading was that we traded my Ford Edge for a Ford F-150. And that opened up a whole bunch of new opportunities for us to pull different campers. And so we were no longer forced to try to get under that 3,500 weight limit. We could then go thousands of pounds heavier. And we started to kind of think, you know, what did we really want in a camper? And did this fit our needs the best?
Of course, F-150s aren't one size fits all. There are different things that you have to worry about as far as like hitch sizes and if it has a brake controller and what the axle ratio is. I learned a whole bunch of stuff that I still just know about this much about, but enough to know that all those things affect towing capacity. And so our F-150 will now tow 10,500 pounds as a maximum. And so we went from 3,500 pound towing max up to 10,500. So it really increased the range of things that we could tow. And with that, we've learned that I think that ultralight campers, those low weight items, are built with low weight materials, and typically low weight materials aren't quite as sturdy as, of course, solid wood and steel and those types of things, but all those things are heavier. And so ultralight models, you may get a little more flimsy.
And so when we started looking at different models we might want to trade into, we weren't necessarily looking for something large. We liked being one of the smaller campers. But we were also thinking about comfort. With my health problems and surgeries that I've had, having a full queen size bed that I can just walk around to and not have to climb over Darren because he has to sleep diagonal, little features like that started to become a little bit more important. we weren't necessarily going to like trade right at 6 months, but we kind of found a model that we really liked, and it's about 6 feet longer, we'll tell you here at the end, but it just gave us a little bit more space to be comfortable.
And so to Steph's point, owning the Rpod for a little while and getting out and using it quite a bit this season, it really helped us to kind of understand what we liked and what we disliked about camping. And so I think it's a good idea to talk about some of the features or lack of features in the Rpod that led us to at least considering other options. And so that first one that she mentioned is the bed. And so again, I'm 6'3", the length of this bed, and it's turned sideways, and so it fits wall to wall. So head to toe goes wall to wall. And so at 6'3", the bed distance was 74 inches, and that's 6'2". And so if I slept straight, my head and feet touched the walls. And at a slight diagonal, we could do it, but it just wasn't that comfortable. And as Steph mentioned, she had to climb over me to get out. And with her having some health and pain issues, that was difficult. And so that was one of the things that led us to want to trade. So one of the other things that led us to wanting to trade is just the towability of the Rpod. We mentioned that it just seemed to bounce around and sway, and it just wasn't quite as easy to tow as we expected it to be, being smaller. And so when we were looking to new options, we were looking for things with like dual axles and a little bit more weight to maybe stay a little straighter and sway less. Plus the heavier trailers will require like a weight distribution system, which is gonna have built-in sway control as well. And on our first experiences towing the new one, which you'll find out again more about later, it tows much, much better, and it just feels better back there. A couple other things, a walkable roof. Roof maintenance is something that is very common and needed very regularly on an RV that we found out. The Rpod did not have a walkable roof. You have to put plywood sheets across the top of it to get up there to distribute the weight. We were looking at models that had walkable roofs. Other things that led us to looking to trade, build quality. As we mentioned, that ultralight build quality just seemed a little subpar. And as we were looking for a new option, we were looking for those different manufacturers that may have a little higher build quality. And with that, of course, means more weight, which we can now handle.
We had decided that we were kind of all in on camping. The first 6 months, we weren't really sure because we didn't have any experience at all, but we had decided we really loved going out on the weekends, even just close to home. And then we decided we think we'd like to do this for years to come. And that's where some of the problems with the Rpod came to like the front, because we started to have concerns about the long-term durability of an Rpod. We know that there are people out there that have taken great care of these for 10 plus years. They're those, you know, diehard loyal fans who do a great job of maintaining some of the older models, but our 2020 Rpod just seemed to have an issue every time we took it out. And Darren is the kind of person who he is gonna do all the research and all the maintenance. And even with our hardest devotion, there always seemed to be a little issue.
Yeah, and so we fully understand that you're bouncing your little house down the road, and so things are gonna rattle loose, shake loose. But like Steph mentioned, we did have a problem pretty much every time out, and nothing was ever super major, with the exception of maybe one. But just a quick rundown of some of the issues we had. And so we had a window that leaked out of the factory because of poor installation. Just like the job of installing it wasn't good. They had missed some track with some screws and left the window kind of floating loose, and so water kept coming in there. We ended up repairing that ourselves because it was so slow to get windows from the factory. We'd mentioned that our tongue jack died. That was nothing on our fault. There's a little cap, a rubber seal on top that was closed, but water was able to seep around it and fry the motor, and so we needed a new one of those. On our trip to Michigan, we rattled our air conditioner to bits. By the time we got to Michigan and turned on our air, it was banging and clanging, and by the end of that week, it wouldn't turn on at all. And that was also due to poor installation or poor design even, but some bushings and screws had completely rattled out of the unit, and the fan was just laying up in the case on top of the camper, and so there was that. We mentioned build quality. Just some little odds and ends around the camper, like the chair backing on our dinette had been really roughly cut, and we just weren't impressed that someone didn't take much more care than that, that they would use just a chewed up piece of wood to finish off something that someone was going to buy. And we found several instances of that throughout the camper where shoddy work had been done with things that were just barely hidden from the naked eye, and so that gave us a little concern of, if that's the kind of work that was done on things that are easy for us to see, you know, what kind of work was done underneath the floor with the wiring back in the walls? We honestly had a little fear of fires and things like that, just because we worried about the quality of the wiring and the electrical work and things like that, just because of the craftsmanship just not being up to the quality that we had hoped for the amount of money that we spent on this trailer.
And we've heard that because campers are so popular right now that companies are pushing them out of the factory as fast as possible. And so we don't know if that's, you know, just a one-off experience that we had with, you know, the workmanship, or if that's a 2020, 2021 experience with, you know, the sudden surge in campers. We just had concerns that the camper was not going to hold up for years on end, even when we devoted a lot of time to the maintenance. It also was a short season camper for us. Here in Indiana, it gets cold in the spring and cold in the fall, and then winter is not really camping season at all. And the underside of the Rpod was not enclosed, and so you had to winterize pretty early in the season, and then you were left with dry camping, which we haven't done too much of, but you just couldn't use the camper for, you know, the entire year or even the extended season like we wanted to.
Yeah, so I think that gives a pretty good explanation of both points of view, the pros, the cons, the things to think about. We definitely don't want to dissuade you from buying an Rpod. We really, really loved getting out in it. And we didn't make a trade due to the lack of size. We're pretty minimal when it comes to travel. We travel overseas in backpacks for the most time, or at most carry-ons. And so packing small in the Rpod was really no problem for us, and we liked that cozy environment. And we don't want to, like I said, talk you out of buying one. We did really enjoy it, and there are a lot of good uses, and it may fit you perfectly as a first camper, as a last camper, or as a whatever, a forever camper. And so just take this information as information and use it to make your decision. Just to reiterate, we're fully aware that things happen in campers. They are houses that move down the road at 65, 70 miles an hour if you're going too fast. So we understand things are going to go wrong. We're not naive to that. Things will come disconnected. Things will rattle loose. And so hear us there. We understand that. We're just sharing the things we experienced.
So that brings us to this, the camper that we are sitting in now, which is a Grand Design Imagine XLS 22 MLE.
I think you got all the letters in there. Yes, and so we did make quite the jump in size, and so we'll give you just a brief summary on this camper, but not give too much away. I will tell you that we looked at a model from Grand Design called an Imagine XLS 17 MKE, which was about the same length as our Rpod, because we did want to stay small. But when we got to looking, we found out that this camper that we're sitting in is a 26-foot camper, so you get about 6 more feet from our original camper, 4 more feet from the MKE, for about the same price, and we love the floor plan, and so we made the jump, and here we are.
It had some of the features that we really wanted. It was dual axle, it had a walk-around bed, and the whole build of the camper is just more sturdy and durable.
And so stay tuned for that, hopefully in the next couple weeks, and you can get a full tour inside and out of every feature, and we'll even throw some science in there and tell you what makes this just a better built camper than the Rpod. At a higher price point, of course, but for now, I think it made a great option for us for a little bit longer term camping. We hope to have this for years to come.
And we are already planning our trips for 2021. We've got a long trip already booked and a couple short trips already booked, so you can be on the lookout for those coming later this year as well.
So if you liked this video, please give it a thumbs up, and if you want to be notified first of that next video, that full tour of the Grand Design Imagine XLS 22 MLE, hit the bell to be notified, and we'll see you in the next video. Thanks for watching.
Bye.